Welcome to Lingthusiasm, a podcast that's enthusiastic about linguistics. I'm Lauren Gawne.
And I'm Gretchen McCulloch. And today, we're getting enthusiastic about small talk. But first, thank you so much to everybody who helped us celebrate our anniversary month in November. We really enjoyed hearing and seeing all of your shares to help other people find the show and be able to listen to a podcast that's enthusiastic about linguistics.
Most podcasts still find new ears or new eyes, if they have transcripts like ours, by word of mouth. So whether you shared in the anniversary month in November or you want to share Lingthusiasm at any other time of the year, we're always incredibly grateful.
This month's bonus episode is a Q&A with lexicographer Emily Brewster, who works for Merriam-Webster, answering patron questions about dictionaries and how they're made and how words get into them and out of them and all sorts of things in that direction. So you can listen to that and a whole bunch of other bonus episodes, almost twice as much Lingthusiasm, by going to patreon.com/lingthusiasm.
Hey Gretchen, how's your book going?
Oh, well, you know, so it's been out for a bit over a year now. Came out in paperback earlier this year, so the media I've been doing for it has been dying down, which is nice to take a bit of a break. But people are still tagging me about them reading it on social media, and that's really nice. What I've actually been working on this year has been this series of intralinguistics videos with this big educational YouTube channel, Crash Course. As you know, Lauren, because you've been working on it with me.
I say that as a very well-practiced answer to that question.
I mean, it's a question that people have been asking me for 5 years now. So the answer does keep changing, but I have had a lot of practice.
I imagine it's definitely in high rotation for people making small talk with you.
Yeah, it's a good way of getting into this idea of small talk, you know, questions, asking about people's lives, and how we think about, you know, what types of things we can use to sort of get into a conversation about how someone's been doing or what someone's been doing lately.
This kind of small talk is something that is really important for building or maintaining social relationships, whether that is with the waiter at the cafe you're at or with your friends or family members. And the name small in small talk is a little bit misleading because it kind of diminishes what is actually a really important social function of this kind of language, where it helps us ease into relationships, whether that be with the waiter at our local cafe or, you know, our closest family members and friends.
Yeah, and I think that there's a sense that small talk is either really easy or really difficult, or, you know, kind of what's going on there and can we analyze those types of conversational turns in a linguistically interesting manner? I definitely think we can. And I want to pause and distinguish small talk, which are these questions, you know, how are things going? How's the book? How's the job? How's the baby? How's living in the place you're living still? You know, how about that local sports team? Nice weather we've been having lately. Those are small talk conversations, and they're not quite as rote as another topic we've talked about before, which is phatic expressions. And that's things like, hey, no problem, bye, thanks, which are really very rote and very ritualized. So when you say, like, how's it going? Good, how are you? That's phatic. But when you say, you know, how are things these days? And you're like, oh, well, you know, not too much, I've been doing this. That's when we start getting into small talk, when it's a little bit more original, but often not that original, because you do end up with that certain level of rehearsal.
Definitely trotting well-worn ground, sometimes in small talk. Sometimes it can take you in surprising directions. I always find it interesting which topics of conversation are appropriate small talk and how that can vary across different groups of people or entire cultures. And it's part of the whole collection of things that you have to learn about learning a language beyond just learning specific words and sentences. Have you found yourself in the middle of a small talk, different set of expectations before?
Yeah, I mean, I always have this experience whenever I manage to successfully make small talk about sports that I feel like I've really gotten away with something. Like, sometimes I'll be talking with one person, you know, about, in Canada, it's hockey. Montreal Canadiens had this big hockey game, blah, 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 this thing happened. Or, like, you know, Canada versus the US, the Olympics, that hockey game generally makes Canadian news. And I'll learn, like, oh, it went to overtime, and they're like, there was this big save last minute or something like that. And then I'll get to mine it for small talk for, like, a week. And I always feel like I've kind of gotten away with something.
Good making use of your limited engagement with sport.
I mean, I don't engage with sport zero amount of the time, but I definitely don't have as much a kind of deep engagement with sport as a lot of people do. So I feel like I've, you know, sort of entered a different world when I managed to have small talk about sport.
Yeah, I always find it interesting how small groups of people have their own kind of expectations about what topics of small talk are appropriate. And it's always really a bit of a relief when you find a social group where they do the same kind of set of hobby references or things like favorite films and TV shows.
Oh yeah, totally.
As the basis of small talk. And it's just like, oh, okay, this is a conversation that I can easily navigate. It's always a delight if you share those media references with people.
And it's really interesting because you can kind of be trapped in that conversation of like, oh, here are two people who are just making references from The Office at each other, and I haven't seen The Office, or insert TV show that's popular that you haven't seen. And in some cases, you can pick up references, you know, like I know all of the references from Mean Girls because enough people have seen it, or I know all the references from like Oregon Trail, which, like, that very early video game that people played, even though I never played it, because, you know, here's, like, you know, you have died of dysentery, so-and-so has died of dysentery, is just like a phrase that gets repeated. So even though I haven't played that game, I can make these references to a certain level of depth.
Yeah, there's the like small talk topics of conversation, and then there's the media references that you use to build out rapport with people as well, which is like another extra level of kind of solidarity building and group building in the small talk process. And Sylvia Sierra is a linguist who's done some really nice work on the Oregon Trail, which is, I assume, why you brought that example up.
Yes, Sylvia Sierra has this great paper that's about video game references as resources in friend interaction and how people quote video games, especially I think it's like Gen X and millennials quote video games as part of conversation to, you know, shift things into a more playful aspect for a serious topic, or ways of, you know, kind of maintaining group identity.
Listening to how Gen X's do that and why people do these media references has made me feel a lot less threatened by people who like weave poetry or like Shakespeare references in, especially like, you know, people from a century ago who just add a bit of like a Shakespearean subtext to their conversation. It's like, oh, they're just doing what we do now with The Office.
It's the same thing. Yeah, it's funny. So speaking of Shakespeare, one play that was really popular during Shakespeare's era was Troilus and Cressida, where you have these two kind of young lovers-ish, and they have this sort of slightly creepy uncle who's named Pandarus, who like tries to put them together and get them together. And this is where our verb like to pander comes from.
Ah.
It's actually like a very old embedded media reference that people have forgotten about. And I recently read Troilus and Cressida for like reasons. And I was like, wait, this is the origin of this. And then you start spotting it in other Shakespeare plays where he has this like Troilus and Cressida reference, which is kind of like having a modern, you know, play or show or something that's like, oh, you know, like my book has a Hamilton reference. And it's kind of the equivalent of like, here's this popular media property that you did your riff on and that you make your references for.
Yeah, I feel a lot less cultural insecurity around supposedly highbrow stuff like Shakespeare when you start realizing the parallels with how we do quoting of media references these days.
And also, this is something that I bring up a lot when I do media interviews with people who are in a generation or two older from me. They're like, oh yeah, my kids, they just talk in memes now. Like my teenager, like their friends just talk in memes to each other. And it's like, yeah, they're just doing media references. And when you were their age, you used popular movies or popular songs and you quoted lines from those. You know, maybe you quoted lines from Beatles songs or something. And this is the same thing that they're doing, except the stuff they're quoting is memes or popular videos on TikTok or something, or popular GIFs, rather than, you know, quoting from movies or kind of mass-produced cultural artifacts.
Definitely a good way to really make sure your group of people you're talking to are in on the same page of knowledge.
And I think people find it reassuring because it's like, oh, well, you know, quoting movies didn't destroy society and quoting memes is not going to do that either.
the flip side of having a small group of people with whom you've built small talk on recurring references is when you find yourself in a situation where you and the person you're talking to just have completely different cultural expectations of how small talk should function. And we've had an earlier episode about how conversation can vary between people. And, you know, there's a much more highly involved style of conversation, and there's a much less highly involved style of conversation. But in terms of small talk, we also have different genre expectations about what fits into small talk.
There's kind of that often quoted thing about, you know, you don't talk about politics or religion at the dinner table, which is not true for everybody, but it's sort of quoted as a beginner level version of that.
Yeah, so we do have some awareness about what we think of as appropriate topics for conversation. I had to really relearn how to do small talk in Nepal because there is a cultural expectation, and some people have talked about it as this genre of your small talk that you do with strangers and people you don't know very well is a kind of suffering story genre where to show people how resilient you are, you tell them about all the bad things that have happened in your life. Whereas my cultural script on this is that you don't tell strangers all the bad things. You don't want to. There's a feeling that that is an imposition on someone you don't know very well to kind of lay out all of your problems in
life. You don't want to be seen as a complainer or something.
Yeah, I think that's a feature of small talk that wouldn't be very controversial to say about kind of Western cultures in general. And so it really took me a lot of time to get my head around the fact that people would tell me all these really, you know, exhausting, terrible events in their lives, and not because they wanted anything of me or they wanted me to fix it or feel sorry for them, but just that this is the way that you show someone how authentic a person you are.
I think I've been in a version of that conversation in kind of Western English-speaking contexts when people start talking about like travel problems that they've had. You're like, and then my flight was delayed for 3 weeks. You know, like,
yeah, I think once that genre does open up for Westerners, there's a bit of like
kind of one-upmanship,
you know, trying to outdo each other. Yeah, and there's definitely a, you know, the problem when you say these things is like big cultural generalizations is like, of course individual conversations don't bear out like this, but it was really relieving when I started reading some anthropological like literature on small talk in Western countries and small talk and genre appropriateness in Nepal, and just like, this has a name. It's a known thing that other people have observed, this cultural difference as well.
Yeah, there's another genre of small talk, which is what I think of as the who's your father genre.
Okay, that I have several potential understandings of how that could go. What is this genre?
So this is a genre that I grew up with in Nova Scotia, which is when you meet someone, you need to figure out how you may or may not be related to them. And even if you aren't necessarily related to them by blood, you need to figure out if you are or not acquainted with some member of their family.
Right. Yeah.
And I knew growing up in this, you know, that in certain contexts, I needed to cite my mom's side of the family, or my mom's mom's side of the family, or my mom's dad's side of the family, because who do I need to cite so that the person who I'm talking to can place me?
Right.
In this lineage sense. And even now, if I'm talking to relatives, sometimes somebody will come up and it'll be like, oh, so-and-so, oh, you know them because their kid was your age who you would have known, blah, blah, blah.
That is definitely not a small talk genre that I encountered growing up nearly as much as that.
Well, and I don't do it as much now in my daily life living in a city, but there is sort of an academic version of that as well, where you meet somebody at an academic conference and they say, oh, I'm a grad student at this university. And you say, oh, you know, who's your advisor? Do you know so-and-so who I know who works at this university?
Oh my gosh, it's so funny because when you were talking about small town Nova Scotia, I was like, that's a weird genre of conversation. And then I was like, oh my gosh, I absolutely do that at conferences. Yeah, you're right.
You've done the academic version of that. And so like, it can be easy to be like exoticize this, like, oh, this is a small town, but you can also do this in the professional sense of like, oh, you worked at this place, or like, you studied at this place. Do you know this person who also works on this topic? Or do you know this person who, and they'd be like, oh yeah, they're my advisor, or whatever.
Yeah. I have had that small talk at conferences many, many times.
Oh yeah, it's like, name a university and I'll tell you if I know someone in the linguistics department.
I want to return to this idea of questions and the kind of, because like that is absolutely a go-to set of questions that I ask at conferences. And I feel like part of learning to navigate social interaction and learning to navigate this kind of small talk is having a little mental booklet of appropriate questions to ask in appropriate settings. And that is totally a set of conference questions that I have.
And in the academic context, asking somebody where they're from, this tripped me up in my first few conferences. It's not asking them where they grew up or even necessarily where they live, but it's like, what university are you at? And
yeah.
When I go to academic conferences now, people will say, where are you from? And I know they're trying to ask.
How do you deal with that now?
I know they're trying to ask what university I'm at. So I'll say, I'm actually not at a university. So I'm answering the assumption in that question.
Yeah.
Even though it's not overtly in the question, but I live in Montreal and I did my master's at McGill or something, so they can kind of place me in their academic genealogy. But it's helpful to answer the hidden assumption in that question.
I always find it incredibly awkward when you enter a small talk situation where someone's set of go-to questions don't quite match up with what you feel comfortable talking about. So sometimes it's because you might be in an incredibly professional work setting and someone's asking you questions about like your family. It's like, well, how many kids I have is not really relevant to talking about linguistics, which is what we're here for. But sometimes it is a larger cultural thing around what is or isn't appropriate to pull from your set of small talk questions.
Yeah, like there's a kind of often cited distinction, and I expect this one may start breaking down when you start looking at smaller subcultures, like many things, but there's an often cited distinction between American versus French small talk conversations, where Americans find it appropriate to say, what do you do for work? Ask people about their jobs, even maybe ask people how much money they make or what they're paying for rent or what they paid for a mortgage or a house.
Yeah, it's funny. Like the first half of those, I'm like, yeah, I would absolutely ask someone what they do for a job. And then I would never feel comfortable asking someone how much money they earn.
I wouldn't ask somebody how much they earn, but I remember being in my first few conversations, especially like as a, you know, young adult starting out on my own, where people were swapping stories of how much they paid in rent for various places. And I found that so helpful. Like, how much are you paying in rent there? So you can kind of get an idea of what the rest of the market looked like in different places. And that bit I've seen people keep doing.
Yeah, it's funny how like maybe if we were all more overt about how much we were paid, we could unionize through small talk.
Yeah, maybe we could. And the comparison is that this is reputedly not socially acceptable in France, where they tend to ask things like, where did you go on your last vacation or what did you do on your last vacation? Which is not necessarily a small talk topic that I would bring up with somebody, because maybe it's presumptuous to assume they went or did somewhere interesting for vacation.
Yeah, interesting. Yeah, that is definitely not in my set of go-to questions. How do you feel about the genre of do you have kids or do you have pets?
I mean, the thing is, I'm sure they're very interesting for people who do have kids or pets, but because I don't, it's just like a conversational dead end for me.
Yeah.
So I have to be like, you know, do you want to hear about my tomato plants? Or because like, I know you're trying to have small talk here, but like no kids, no pets is really like, or I have to kind of like adopt somebody else's kids or pets and be like, oh no, I don't have kids. But like, you know, like my friend who has a kid who I was visiting just last week, you know, it doesn't lead anywhere for me.
Yeah. I kind of sometimes feel a bit the opposite where like, I know it's a small talk question and I should have a really pat answer, but I'm also just like living with a toddler hurricane and I'm afraid that I will have like too much information to share at someone. And I think it's this thing where because this is kind of ritualized small talk and we're just doing it to build solidarity or pass time or establish some kind of like common ground, you know, for one person in the conversation, it's like it's not really an important question. They just pulled it out of their mental list of questions. And for the other person, it is an all-consuming part of their life. Like, there are definitely points where I would not have asked you how the book is going.
I mean, I did get asked how the book was going pretty much constantly for 5 years while I was writing it and when it was coming out and so on. And some people were very apologetic about asking me to be like, oh, I'm so sorry for asking, but the only small talk conversation I can think of to ask you is, dare I ask how the book is going? Which was this sort of interesting relationship, especially academics would often act like that, because in academia, there's this sort of constant tension around, like, how's the thesis going? Or how's the dissertation?
Oh, yeah, I definitely, because it's such a big project to write a PhD thesis, and people are often acutely stressed at various or many points throughout that process. Obviously, when I ask my own PhD students, it's a very different question, right? Because they have to tell me what they're up to. But basically, for anyone else, I don't ask them until they bring it up, which is a kind of meta information tracking happening in the list of small talk questions. It's like, oh, well, now you've mentioned your dissertation, that means you must feel okay to, or I'll do a lot of that hedging, kind of like, oh, don't tell me if it's too stressful, but like, how's the dissertation? And that's very different to someone who just vaguely knows you're writing a book or doing a thesis or something.
Yeah, and for me it was interesting because, you know, there were definitely points in writing the book where I was stressed, but I didn't find the questions stressful, because if I was feeling stressed at the time, it wasn't like I was thinking about anything else.
Yeah.
So I might as well just tell you that I'm stressed. or I might as well just tell you the, well, like, oh, I've submitted this one draft and I'm working on another draft now, or something like that. Like, I would generally have some sort of answer to that question because it was just so ubiquitous in terms of how it was taking over my life. And I also kind of thought, well, you know, I want people to buy this book when it comes out. So if they're going to keep asking about it, that's probably a good sign, right? Because that means they know I'm writing one. And so I wasn't as annoyed about it as maybe someone with a dissertation where they're not trying to sort of market it at the same time, where I was like, well, if they're asking about my book, maybe they'll want to read it. Maybe they'll want to buy it.
I like your understanding of what's happening in the small talk dynamic there. I mean, I think part of what happens when you think you're just asking a, like, you know, how's the book or how's the kid? And then you like get this response where someone's like, we were up all night, they didn't sleep, they're teething. And you're like, oh, okay, I don't know what to do here. I think part of the tension here is going back to the idea of phatics that we talked about in that earlier episode, where phatics are very much not about information. They're just a kind of little dance that you do with each other to like be polite. And I think the problem is when you sometimes ask a question and you're asking it in a much more phatic kind of like, how's the weather? How's your kids? Just like, all good.
Yeah. And there's a sense of what, like, how's your ex, where ex is like something they mentioned last time or something you know about them, you know, how's the job going? You don't really necessarily expect to hear, oh, everything is terrible. And I'm planning on quitting. You know you might hear it, but you kind of want to hear, oh, I'm working on this now, or something like that. It's a way of trying to ask for a little bit more information, and yet on the receiving end, that question still feels very personal.
Yeah, so one person's treating it far more like a phatic interaction, and the other one's treating it as a, like, much less phatic conversation topic.
Yeah, and it's interesting because I feel like this is one of the areas of language that you learn how to do comparatively late in, you know, your development as a child and adolescent and so on. And I remember when I was later teenager, you know, at like holidays, summer breaks, family reunions, you know, seeing family that you maybe see a couple times a year. And it was really helpful for me that my mom would coach me into saying, you know, you're going to be seeing a bunch of relatives over the next week. They're going to ask you how school's going. It would be good if you think of a 2-3 sentence answer that you can give them that tells them something you're okay with them knowing and, like, lets you have a satisfying interaction there. As you could be like, oh, you know, I'm in grade 11 now and we're working on this thing and it's interesting for me. And she would coach me to think of that in advance and be like, you can give the same answer to all of the relatives.
Oh my gosh, your mom should have been a discourse analyst.
I really think she had a missed calling here. And that was really helpful for me because I feel like this is my first, like, media training, because, like, every single interview I did about the book, someone always says, why did you write this book? And you have to have an answer to that. And you have to not be annoyed that you're giving the same answer to that. And the same thing is, like, every single time you see a relative that you haven't seen for a year or two, they're going to say, how's the whatever going, whether that's how's school or how's your job or how's the city you're living in, or they're trying to remember a noun that vaguely applies to you.
Oh, I love the experience with relatives. I mean, relatives in particular that you see like once every year or so, or like old family friends, because they'll be like, how's the basketball going? And you're like, I have not played basketball for 5 years and I was very bad at it at the time. Like, and it's that, I think it's so much easier to come from a place of, oh, they're just trying to have this social engagement with me rather than a point of irritation.
Yeah, it's so easy to get irritated. And yet what the person's trying to do is express interest in your life. And if they say, you know, how's basketball going? Or for me, it was like, how's debate going? Which was like a really good question for a while. And then I stopped doing it. And can say like, oh, actually, I'm not doing that much anymore. What I am doing is this. Because they don't know that they should be asking you about your new hobby. But you can just kind of segue into the new hobby.
Yeah, it's not that they want a factual report based on their question. It's not illegal interrogation.
Right. And thinking about kind of the meta question behind the question was also what let me figure out how to finally give a satisfying answer to the ubiquitous question, so you're a linguist, how many languages do you know?
This is definitely one of those things where if you aren't a linguist, it seems like a perfectly reasonable question to ask. If you are, it's that asymmetry in how frequently you have to have this conversation, right? Where you might not talk to many linguists, and so you want to ask them questions like this. And as the person on the receiving end of it, you are constantly asked, how's your thesis? How many languages do you speak? And it can be very, for a long time, my immediate reaction to that question was frustration. But as you say, understanding the real question there is just, what do you do?
Right. So if you happen to mention, like, your cat, a natural thing for someone to do in conversation would be like, oh, how many cats do you have? And the person at the other end doesn't care how many cats you actually have, right? They don't care if you have one cat or two cats or three cats. The next thing they're going to ask is, like, how old are they? And what are their names? And just, like, they're going to lead into the, like, oh, let's get the person to talk about their cats. Or same thing with kids. The person doesn't care how many kids you have. They're just trying to make conversation.
Yeah.
And the thing that they think about when they hear linguist is language. And so they're like, I don't know, let's just put a question in front of language. And the thing that I did for a while is I would kind of go into, you know, in great detail, all of the languages that I had, like, vaguely learned a little bit of, because I was excited about this. And I would have all these sorts of caveats around, well, I don't really, you know, you don't really speak Latin, but it was interesting because you learn how to translate it and to read it. And, you know, like, do we even know what it means to know a language? Like, to what extent do I blah, blah, blah? And nobody was satisfied with this interaction. Like, I knew it wasn't working for me because it was this very long and detailed answer and didn't give the other person space to keep asking me questions or to answer some of their own questions. The answer was too long. Mm-hmm. And if it felt complete to me, it also felt intimidating. People would be like, wow, that's a ton of languages. And I'd be like, yes, but I don't actually speak them any very well. And what I learned to do instead was just pick one language that I feel like talking about right now and that this person would probably be somewhat interested in it, and just answer with that one language and with a bit of a story to it. Mm-hmm. Right? And so somebody says, how many languages do you know? And I say, you know, it's really interesting living in Montreal because there's so much French and I speak French. And that gives them the space to ask questions about Montreal. Or to say, oh, I visited Montreal once, it was very nice. And then we're having a conversation where there's a bit more back and forth, there's a bit of question and answer, the person can say something, or, oh, I've always wanted to visit Montreal, or whatever. Or they can talk about their speaking or non-speaking of French. And it doesn't lead me into this sort of exhaustive laundry list that nobody's really happy about. And so it leaves open in the later conversation if they mention Spanish or something like, oh, I speak a bit of Spanish too. So you're not lying, but you're kind of seeing the question for the purpose behind it and answering that purpose rather than getting hung up on the specific details of the wording of that question. Because the how many isn't actually the part they're interested in. It's the, so you're a linguist, you must like languages, right? Tell me something about language.
What I really appreciate is that you have used your linguist powers to do some analysis of what's happening in the conversations that you're having to more effectively do small talk. And I think that's a really great example of applying linguistics that we don't often give people credit for.
I mean, this is kind of one of the holy grails of linguistics in my mind, is to understand that sort of meta question, understand sort of what's going on. And I think of it in terms of Gricean maxims, in terms of pragmatics, which is another thing we've also done an episode about. This is the callback episode. which is the idea that anything that you say in a conversation, the other person will interpret as relevant to the conversation, and they'll seek ways to construe it as relevant to what's being said. So if they say how many languages and you reply naming one thing about one language, that's enough for that to be relevant to the conversation, for the conversation to keep going, even though like you don't have to do exact literal responses to everything, because sometimes what people are asking is actually a sort of different thing at a meta level.
Yeah, I think about small talk a lot from the perspective of something I find really interesting, which is tracking knowledge state. So what the other person knows and what they might want to know. It's kind of basically coming to the same conclusion as you, just with my own particular interest in what language tries to achieve in conversations. And so kind of going, well, the only reason they're asking me about this thing that I am bored to death of talking about is because they haven't heard about it yet. And so finding that as a way to feel more at peace, especially years and years of doing retail, I found just kind of being very zen about like, it's maybe the umpteenth time I've done this week, but like this person doesn't know about this thing.
Yeah, like, where are the bathrooms? Look, I can just tell you, I've said this so many times today, but it's fine.
So using linguistics to make small talk more pleasant for you and the people that you are talking to, which may be useful if you happen to be listening to this in an impending holiday season, or if you're starting a new job, or if you're at a conference, kind of having some ways to navigate small talk are useful in so many ways.
I also think it's useful in contexts where even answering a question like, how are you, feels awkward because you're going through a hard time and you don't feel like it's honest to say, oh, I'm good. But you don't necessarily want to share, or acquaintances don't necessarily want to hear the full story about how terrible things have been. And so this post on Tumblr, which we'll link to, gives the advice to say any at least mildly interesting fact about something you experienced relatively recently, the last few days. Like, my cat got stuck in a cereal box today. like, here's something that's on my mind. Or like, you know, I got a package in the mail or something like this. And people will interpret it as a valid answer to how are you. People will sort of take that at face value, and they'll take that as the kind of non-answer that it is, where you don't necessarily want to declare that the whole world is fine, because sometimes it feels like the whole world is on fire, or your corner of the world is on fire. But you don't necessarily want to have that fire conversation.
Yeah, absolutely. We say at the end of 2020. Use the power of conversational relevance to divert. Yeah, and I think knowing that it's okay to steer the small talk boat and that is still meeting the aim of the small talk is a good thing to know.
Yeah, and, you know, to go back to talking about, like, here are all the terrible things I've experienced in my life, doing the, like, oh my god, the news, it's so terrible and I can't believe how terrible it is. Sometimes you have that back and forth of, like, oh, it's so terrible, yes, it's terrible.
That's the Nepali-style solidarity building through suffering.
It does build solidarity. And I think that kind of gets us into this question of how can we use our knowledge of small talk and the agendas of small talk, the meta questions or the knowledge states that people exist in, to make small talk feel good for what you're trying to feel at the moment, whether that's to build solidarity or whether that's to distract you from what's going on in the world. What can you do to shift the direction of a particular small talk thing?
And alongside that, I think looking at your list of questions that you potentially have to also steer the conversation. I have occasionally had, you know, those super awkward moments with a group of work colleagues where no one has had a question that's allowed people to open up in a way that feels appropriate for that space. And then someone has asked a question that's like worked really well or said something that's like, and I file that away. And I'm like, oh, asking if anyone's tried any new recipes lately worked really well in this work context. It might flunk in another work context, but that's now in my brain as an option to kind of keep things going. And I think open questions really help people to take it and run in a direction that they feel comfortable with. As someone who was asked for far too many years after they graduated if they were a PhD student in a work context, it's just safer to ask open questions. Or just inflate someone, you know. It's like, are you a lecturer? But even then, that can backfire.
Oh, yeah. Everyone loves being asked if they're a prof.
Yeah.
One of the questions that I have that I use a lot in conference settings are, how's your conference going? Because this works for pretty much everybody. You can ask the same person this question multiple times on different days.
It doesn't matter if they're a PhD student who's here to just be an audience member or if they're a prof giving a plenary.
It works in non-academic contexts, which is a lot of my conferences now. Another one that I have, which is kind of a holdover from my time in academic conferences, is what are you working on? Because this seems to be a common question in academia. But in non-academic settings, I like it too, because it kind of leaves open the question of, you know, this could be a side project, this could be a hobby, this could be a thing you're doing at your job. It leaves that a little bit more open than what do you do for work. Another conference that I was at recently, we were doing a kind of virtual networking event and kind of sitting around a virtual table, and somebody said, what's something you worked on recently that you're proud of? And I was like, oh, this is a really neat way to get to know the people at this table, because it gets everybody the opportunity to be like, oh, I wrote this article for this place, or like, oh, I did this thing, and gives people the opportunity to sort of share their work and share something about them. So I like that one. I'm gonna use that again.
I'm going to add that to my list, too.
The other piece of, you know, hacking small talk tips that I learned when I was maybe about 13, I think I was a young teenager. I remember being in my childhood bedroom when I read this book, and it was one of those like self-help books. And I took one sentence out of it, but it's been a very useful one sentence, which is about all you can demand out of a self-help book.
Yeah. What's this sentence? I want to know. I can't believe you left this till the end. This is like one of those like bad self-improvement life hacking podcasts all of a sudden.
Please listen to us for half an hour to get the one golden sentence. And maybe this is more obvious to people who weren't, you know, 13 at the time and had done more kind of networking events, which I have not done very much when I was 13, admittedly. And this was the notion of the occasion / location statement.
Okay. Can you unpack that for me?
Yes, exactly. I will write you a whole little self-help book. When you're in an environment with strangers or acquaintances, people you're trying to strike up a conversation with, one thing that you can do that is not weird is you can look around and make some sort of remark about either the occasion, the kind of event that you're at, or the location, something in the environment.
Right.
So one example of this would be, you're at a party, you don't really know very many people, so you go hang out by the refreshment table, and you start striking up conversation with somebody about, like, the cheese. Like, oh, this cheese looks really good. And then you can kind of segue from that into, you know, yes, this party's been so much fun, blah, blah, blah. Or if you're at, like, someone's birthday party, you can be like, so, how do you know the host? Or the kind of cliche, I've never done this, but, like, at a bar or something, you go up to someone and you're like, so, do you come here often? Or, you know, if you're trying to strike up a conversation with somebody at, like, the post office, you can be like, wow, this line's taking a long time because we're both standing in it, or something like that. It's this thing that you have in common in the environment, either based on the time or the space. And that was how I kind of first started thinking about small talk. Although these days, it also sort of segues into doing events where you hang out in virtual space. And I've been experimenting a lot with doing kind of proximity-based chats where you have, you know, here's this virtual platform which lets you have conversations with more fluid groups of people rather than just being on like a massive video call where only one or two people can talk at once. Mm-hmm. And the thing that's interesting about them is, on the one hand, there's this sort of built-in conversational topic, which is, here's this new platform we're trying out. But on the other hand, that's kind of like being like, oh, look at this cheese tray, or like, look at this chandelier. Like, eventually you want to move on from that into another type of conversation that's something you could have with not just anybody. You know, encouraging people to do introductions, or, you know, introduce themselves in the chat, or introduce themselves with each other, or kind of designating certain conversational topics or certain zones. Like, I've realized that one of the functions of a conference when it comes to making conversation with people is that it gives you a different set of built-in conversational small talk topics that are different from what you have in ordinary life. You can say, like, oh, have you been to any talks that you really liked? And then you can start talking about what happened in the talks. And that gives you an entry into a different type of conversational topic than you might have with somebody that you run into in line in the post office, even though, hypothetically, that person might be able to have that same conversation, but you don't have the shared knowledge that you could enter into it together.
Yeah, and, you know, a small talk experience can just be that moment of small talk and you have a nice chance to interact with each other, or it can be that segue into a much deeper domain specific, or, you know, content specific for linguistics, or, you know, feeling specific if you're with your friends and or family. But it's such an interesting genre to pull apart in and of itself.
Yeah, it's really interesting to think, okay, you know, what do we have that sort of that bridge between your phatic expressions, which are really rote, and your, you know, oh, we're having this conversation that neither of us has ever had before, and we're arriving at all these interesting insights, and you just don't always end up there, and that's okay. It can be a much lower effort to do a conversation where one or both of you has kind of had this conversation before, and you're just having it with each other instead of with somebody else. It's a genre that's interesting to analyze and to figure out how to make satisfying for yourself as its own thing. For more Lingthusiasm and links to all the things mentioned in this episode, go to lingthusiasm.com. You can listen to us on Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, Spotify, SoundCloud, YouTube, or wherever else you get your podcasts. And you can follow at Lingthusiasm on Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, and Tumblr. You can get IPA scarves, IPA socks, and other Lingthusiasm merch at lingthusiasm.com/merch. I can be found as at Gretchen A. McSee on Twitter. My blog is allthingslinguistic.com. My book about internet language is called Because Internet, now in paperback.
I tweet and blog as Superlinguo. Have you listened to all the Lingthusiasm episodes and you wish there were more? You can get access to 46 bonus episodes to listen to right now at patreon.com/lingthusiasm or follow the links from our website. Patrons also get access to our Discord chat room where they can talk to other linguistics fans and other rewards, as well as helping keep the show ad-free. Recent bonus topics include honorifics, a behind the scenes on writing Crash Course Linguistics, and an AMA with lexicographer Emily Brewster. If you can't afford to pledge, that's okay too. We really appreciate it if you can recommend Lingthusiasm to anyone who needs a little more linguistics in their lives.
Lingthusiasm is created and produced by Gretchen McCulloch and Lauren Gawne. Our senior producer is Claire Gawne, our editorial producer is Sarah Dopirella, and our music is Ancient City by The Triangles.
Stay Lingthusiastic.